It's so nice to see you all here this morning. Will you please stand with us as we begin our worship? We are starting with hymn 87. May Jesus Christ be praised. Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 through 10. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us now not weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap, if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. Galatians 6, 7 through 10.
Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, take.
are going to be singing The Solid Rock. It's hymn number 402. It is a little bit of a different melody than you're used to, so Karen is going to play through it once for us.
Good morning. We want to just take a chance now to look around, see if you can see somebody that's new. Welcome them in this morning. Say hello to familiar faces. Just take a chance to greet the family this morning. goodness. Okay, sit down right there. Good morning. Had the chance to go up this on Friday and Saturday with Nampa Christian's senior class. They took a retreat up to Warm Lake, and good reports. Everything's good up there. Nothing's on fire around the camp. If you're familiar with the area at all up there, you come towards camp, and there's Stoley Meadows Road that you turn off and head south towards Rice Peak and up in that way. And there's this beautiful rock face that's called Cougar Rock. And it's burning right up in that area up there. It's only about 600 acres, and they've got it about 60% contained. The fire service or the Forest Service came down to camp every day and gave us a report and a bunch of extra food and stuff that they had. So it was neat. It was a good time, and the skies are actually clearer up there than they are down here. So it was beautiful. We had stars out every night. But thank you for your prayers. Camp is, so it's on. We're going to have an announcement about men's retreat here in just a few, but just wanted to give you guys a report real quick. Our missionaries of the week this week are Mel and Patty Davis, serving in Slovenia. And what we do is we have a letter from them, kind of gives you an update of what's going on with them. But also downstairs, again, we have our missionary wall down there that you can take a look at and see what's going on with our different missionaries that are supported. But we'd like to give you a chance to send them a note of encouragement. There's a addressed and stamped envelope just to send them off a note. And do it quick. If you're anything like me, you get that thing and you're like, I'll take care of this. And then you find it on your desk a week later. You're like, so just take care of it. Get that thing put in the mail. Send off. And it's amazing what a handwritten letter does for people's emotions and just lifts them up and gets them going again. And then also we have Brent and Don Holly, and they're down in Nicaragua, and we have a big letter from them updating what's going on. And again, we just like to send them a note of encouragement. So if we could just get a hand and get that sent off, thank you very much. We have our verse for today. It's Ephesians 4, 1 through 3. If we could stand, get your exercise this morning, do some up-downs here. And we'll say the passage, the verse, and then the passage again. Ready? Begin. Ephesians 4, 1 through 3. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Ephesians 4, 1 through 3. Sorry, got ahead of myself. It's easy. Go ahead, have a seat. That was one of our verses actually for this weekend about a calling and about challenging the seniors at Nampa Christian. It was kind of a neat experience for them. They got off the bus, and they had never been to Warm Lake before. Usually it's Quaker Hill or Trinity Pines, down where there's cell service and civilization. And so it was a bit of a shock, culture shock for them. They all stared at their phones for a few minutes like they had just died. And they're like, no service. What is this place? Are we on Mars? But it was cool to watch them slowly transition back into teenagers again and just enjoy. And they started just running around, and they found a bunch of gopher holes to stick their ankles in and all sorts of good stuff. But it was so fun to watch. They just had a blast. And just finding different ways to play. And it's so funny. I mean, they would just, they're like, oh, we never played volleyball before. It doesn't matter. Just go play. We've never played disc golf before. It doesn't matter. Just go play. And after a while, they were just having a great time. And they got into dinner on Saturday night, and they were exhausted. It was so funny because they were just all chatty at breakfast. And by dinner time, they're just like, they're like, what just happened to me? Oh, I played today. Yes. It was great. Let's take our morning this morning to the Lord in prayer. What a privilege. Let's take it to God. Precious Father, thank you that you have come to give us life and life to the full, to be fully alive in Christ, to experience the highs of life and the lows. Thank you for the picture of life in your Son, that he didn't protect himself from the difficulties in life, that he did not put himself in a position of just ultimate comfort here on the earth, but he lived a life that we could connect to in every which way. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to follow him and to live fully alive. Lord, I pray for Nampa Christian this school year, Father, that they would be not just in name alone, but a beacon of Christ in the community through each one of the individuals there, the teachers and the students. And I pray that for us as well, that we would just enjoy living life with you, Father, as our guide, as our teacher, as our friend, as our king, and that the world would see our love for you and for your word through not just our words, but through our actions as well. we also lift up our local church bodies this morning. I pray for Eustick Nazarene. Thank you for their body. We just lift them up as they're opening up your word this morning, for Deer Flat, for Canyon Hill, for Montana Avenue, for Boone. Lord, we just pray for them this morning that your word would just be opened and you would be glorified this morning. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Some announcements to be aware of. First of all, if you haven't passed the pad when the outside aisles across, please get that across there so we can register your attendance. If you are a first-time visitor with us this morning, thank you for being here. We really appreciate that and hope you are blessed in our service today. There is a lot of things to be thankful for when you consider church, and there's a lot of people to thank when you consider all the events that we put on, and just a service like this. Think about all the people that put into a service like this, that work behind the scenes or up here. And a lot of times we take those things for granted. Think about where we'd be without coffee in the mornings. Thank you, Stan and Warna. Where would we be without a bulletin? Alice, thank you. And all of the different things that go into a service. And also those events, there's a special thank you here that I want to read. It says, thank you to Betty Adams and the Family Circle for their wonderful music and testimony of the wonderful love of God. Thank you to Mike Howard for preaching. Thank you to the Simplots for donating 300 Idaho russet potatoes. Debbie Buxton and Lori Hart for organizing the delicious potato bar lunch. And Chuck and Harriet Seward for their fabulous decorating of the fellowship hall. And all of you who volunteer to bake potatoes and bring chili, set up and clean up, you are all appreciated, and because of them, of you, many were blessed. Thank you to the volunteers who shopped, baked, and served food to the Cowboys last Wednesday evening. Many blessings back to you. So there is just an example of a major event in our church, but to all those who helped put that on from the church, thank you very, very much. Things to be aware of, again, a reminder, young married couples are meeting Sundays at 6:30, and there's some information in the bulletin about that. Awanas, yes, it's here, Wednesday, September 2nd. At 6:20 is the Awana kickoff, and that's with registration. The following Wednesday, September 9th, 6:20, is the first club meeting. And again, Awana is open to grades K through 6th grade. There's not a Cubbies program available at this time. Listeners are needed, and if you're interested in that or would be able to help with that, please write listeners on your registration slip if you'd like to volunteer. Mug and Muffin, there's going to be an activity there on September 12th. That's at 10 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall with a puppet show for all ages. And Dan's going to come up here in a minute and talk about men's camp. There's a lot more in the bulletin, so please check that out. And children, you are now dismissed for Kids Church.
tendency to play as close as we can to the edge of disaster in many areas of our life. How close to sin, if you're a Christian, how close to sin can I get without sinning is kind of the way we live our lives sometimes. Guardrails are there to keep us from moving into an area where there's actual danger. There needs to be some margin for error. You know what's on the other side of this guardrail financially. You know what's on the other side morally. You know what could happen.
Yes, guys, it's time to pay attention about men's camp. We are going to have a wonderful series that'll take up a little bit of our time up there, second week into September. But today is the day to pay attention about men's camp. And I want to turn your attention to this all-inclusive flyer. It's got everything you need to know about men's camp. Our schedule for the weekend, things to bring. This is the time to bring your big boy toys, your ATVs, your dirt bikes, your boat. There'll be plenty of time for us to relax and enjoy and to get to know one another a little better. And I guarantee that you will come away with one or two principles that will drastically improve your walk with the Lord. So this is for all the men. We're inviting other churches in the valley to join us. But men, bring your sons, bring your grandsons, and do pay attention to that. We need to have a pretty good head count by next Tuesday, the 1st of September by the latest. So please do pay attention to that. Join us. We're going to have a good time. And now it's my distinct pleasure to introduce Rolando Ortiz. Rolando, come and share with us.
Well, the pleasure is mine. I greatly enjoy coming back here. I remember all the days when I tortured a Sunday school teacher and an Awana's helper, and I say, Lord, thank you for getting me past that, and teacher, thank you for putting up with me. But it is a pleasure to come back and be here. We were here last year, as you know, and we're here again, and we just count it a blessing to be able to share with you at this time. I'm going to reintroduce ourselves really quickly before we go into the message, just so you, of those of you who do not know us, can get a little bit better acquainted. My name isn't easy for some people to remember anyway, but my name is Rolando Ortiz. My mom is Jillian Ortiz, and my dad, Jesse Ortiz, missionaries to Mexico. And also my grandpa is Winston Tilsey here in the back, so that's kind of my roots here. My wife is my special gift from the Lord right there. She's a blessing to our ministry in ways that are only seen from where I'm standing and where I go day by day. And I know anyone who has a wife that supports them knows exactly what that means. But then we have a 2014 model in her hands. It's a sad situation that it leaks often. It's interesting with baby models, the model leaks less as it gets more mileage on it. So we've got the 2014 model, and we have a 2015 model not yet released. It's actually due this next Wednesday, so it's soon to be released. Won't come out on the news, but we'll hopefully come by and visit you again after that so you can meet also our second child. I'm going to go ahead and just say quickly what we're going to be doing in Mexico. Our primary focus is church planning. My dad has been doing the same work, and I'm following in his steps, following his same model, straight out of what the Bible would leave for a model for planting a church. And we want to plant them in areas that have no churches. There are quite a few of these areas in Guadalajara, and it is our conviction at this point that perhaps the place God wants us to go to, and I almost don't even want to say it because it won't help you anywhere, anyway, but it's Tlacomulco de Zúñiga. Don't worry about that. Just pray God help them with the town they're in. He knows where it is. But if you do, think of us, pray for us. As we get closer to going down there, we want to start there. There are no churches there preaching gospel grace. They're not preaching the salvation in Christ alone. They're preaching in the Catholic Church, if you want to call it preaching, They're preaching that you have to earn your way to heaven and make up for your sins by penitence and things like that. So we want to go there and take the gospel as it is presented in the Word of God. Also, we're going to be helping with a Bible college. Pastor Shaw met the people who are running that college down there. We want to help them at least temporarily, maybe one day a week, maybe 2 days a week, whatever's necessary. That they'll just call on us, and we'll try to be in a secondary way trying to help with that Bible college, a small Bible college, but a blessing to see how God's using that over time. If you have any questions on what we're going to be doing, I have a booth back there, a little table set up. Just come ask me whatever. I'll answer, even if it's a ridiculous question of if Taco Bell is actually Mexican or not. I'll answer that question. You just come back and ask me any question you'd like. At this point, open your Bibles, and we're going to look at the passage that continues in Matthew. Matthew chapter 9, verse 14. Matthew chapter 9, verse 14 is where we're going to take off. And as you can see on your notes, I'm going to be talking about Kingdom Q&A about fasting. Kingdom Q&A about fasting. Without raising your hand, I have two questions there. How many of you fasted this week? Without raising your hand, how many believe God wants you to fast? Or if you take it a little bit farther, do you believe that a more spiritual Christian fasts more often than a less spiritual Christian? I guess if you've studied the subject of fasting, you know very well that the Bible has no commandment to a New Testament believer that says you have to fast. None whatsoever. The closest thing to it, a divine commandment to fasting, is that related in the Old Testament to the day of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, which they would fast nationally for one day. But of course, we know that that was never applied to the New Testament believer. That was never connected with the New Testament believer. And along with the rest of the rituals related to that, it was completed in Jesus Christ's death on the cross when he came in 33 AD. I'm not saying that no one fasts in the church. That's a clear thing we have to recognize as well. When you get into the New Testament, you find several examples of fasting after Christ died, after he resurrected, after he ascended to heaven, and you find them several times through Acts used for different reasons. You also, might I give you an example of Jesus, when he talked about fasting, he said in one occasion, when you fast, do this. When you fast. But he didn't say the strong word, you must fast, and then do it this way. Also in our passage, you'll see that Jesus says something very similar. He says, when the bridegroom is taken from the wedding, then they shall fast. You'll notice that when we get there, shall fast. Not they might fast, but also not they must fast. And I think we have to maintain a balance on that and keep to the scriptural wording for it. Jesus automatically assumed and foretold that Christians would fast. But interestingly enough, he did not make it a commandment to do so. And so we enter the important question of this passage. Why? Why fast? Why do that? And we see in this, I believe, one of the most important principles of Christian living. Now, you might not see this, but I think if you dig into it, you'll find what I find, that one of the most profound and most important principles on Christian living is buried in this little section. I believe it is here, and we will get to that in a second. But if we understand rightly what Jesus says, I believe it actually is it can remove us from a self-imposed bondage and actually put us into a position of Christ-driven freedom. Now, this will make sense as we move on. These principles, of course, are not limited to fasting. They go far beyond just fasting. The principles extend to every aspect of Christian living. The very motivation for why we do things is somewhat hinted to in this passage. And so we'll look at that in a little bit. And if you happen to have come to church today and you saw the passage and you said, fasting isn't exactly my forte. I'm not sure I'm interested in studying it. Let's at least give the chance to our Lord and Master to answer this question and see what he has to say. I do believe this is important material. Nothing in the scriptures is less than important, but I do believe this is an outstanding passage concerning the principles it brings out. Let's go to the Lord in prayer before we study this to seek his guidance. Dear God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can come and worship today freely in this country. God, we realize so often we hear something in our country go south and farther from you. and we wake up long enough to hit the alarm and fuss about it, only to hit the snooze button shortly after and fall back asleep until another alarm goes off and we hit the snooze button again. God, I pray that you'd give us an urgency for our country, a heart. Certainly fasting is tied so strongly to prayer, and it's tied to a concerned and powerful, passionate prayer. And God, to some extent, we have lost that. We have found ourselves less concerned about what's going on and more concerned about what we're doing on our daily lives. Help us to find an interest in that. Help us to pray for our country as already has been done today. Help us to reach out to our country. Lord, we do pray also for Mexico as my wife and I prepare to go. Open hearts, prepare the doors. May your Holy Spirit go before us. Lord, speak to us today. Remove the distractions, God. And if I bring a sermon that is an exciting and an excellent sermon, Lord, let it be given all glory to you. And if it's a sermon that is not worth hearing and boring, Lord, let that blame be placed on me. But Lord, let your name be glorified. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. We're going to look at 3 points here. 3 points. The first one, the questioner and their, note, question about fasting. The questioners and their question about fasting. It says, then came to him the disciples of John, saying, why do we and the Pharisees fast oft, but thy disciples fast not? The first thing we find here is a questioners, right? Here they're introduced, and who are they? Who exactly are these people? If we look at the Gospel of Matthew, we find it says it's the disciples of John the Baptist. But if you look at Luke, all of a sudden you find a discrepancy. It says it's the Pharisees. Well, we don't have a problem with that. We call it the principle of additive harmony. Both of them put together makes perfect sense. That was both the Pharisees and the disciples. And if you wanted to find that clearly, Mark puts them both together for us. Now, this is not insignificant. You might think, well, that's what detail, what does that matter? Well, let me tell you, if the questioners were just Pharisees, what would be our automatic assumption about this question? Would we not approach it saying, this is a question purely driven by legalism? Maybe it's like that question they asked about the washing of the hands. You're breaking tradition, Jesus. Maybe they're bringing it up to accuse the disciples of being less spiritual than they were. But it's not just the Pharisees, is it? When we approach this passage, we find that the disciples of John were there too. And the disciples of John were not out to accuse Jesus Christ. They were not out to make him a spectacle. So that tells us that at least some sincerity is involved in this question, right? Some of them are legitimately coming up and saying, Jesus, why? And that should drive part of our conclusion as well. The second thing we look at, by the way, it is driven in your notes that there was some sincerity in the question. There was some. The second question thing that comes up here is the question itself, and what did they ask is what we must see. The question was, why do we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? We can be sure, by the way, and I'll set this as a side note, that the disciples of Jesus probably did fast once a year. And we can be sure that Jesus fasted once a year in completion to the commandment about the Day of Atonement. Jesus Christ fulfilled the law to every last aspect. So he at least fasted once a year. But the disciples were clearly not maintaining a continual form of fasting. Now here's where the contrast comes in. We can look into the Jewish Talmud, and you can look at tradition of Jews, and you find that they fasted twice a week. Twice a week they would fast. So you're looking at the difference between 100 times a year fasting, around 100 times, versus one time a year. It's a stark contrast. We don't know about the disciples of John, because the Bible never actually gives us that answer, but we can assume that being brought up in the Jewish nation, they fasted, probably following the example of the Pharisees, and fasted quite a bit. So this stark contrast comes out, and you can see the drastic difference, and that's why they approached. And some today go about the same question, and I've actually heard people preach about that the most neglected practice in the church today is fasting. Now, you may agree with that, but personally, and I do say this personally, I've have a trouble believing that for several reasons. First of all, how do we know that it's the most neglected practice? If fasting is done biblically, it is a secret practice, is it not? And therefore, the only way we'd know that it was being neglected is if we were parading our fasting, telling everybody about how much we fast. So there is a possibility more fasting goes on than we realize. But also, I'd like to put out that to say that we are neglecting fasting must come as a result to the answering the question, how often, note, how often should we fast? Unless there is a set pattern, we cannot say it's being neglected. If I tell you, go to Taco Bell, and you go once in your lifetime, were you neglecting going to Taco Bell? Or if I say, go to Taco Bell, and you go three times a week, were you neglecting Taco Bell? The fact of the matter is, without the set principle, we can't say precisely that something is being neglected. And that moves us on to the second question, the actual answer itself, the point that says the answer and his answer, the answer and his answer about true fasting. Here's where our Lord Jesus Christ steps in, and these are his words in verse 15. And Jesus said unto them, can the children of the bride chamber mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? But the day will come when the bridegroom shall be taken from them, and then shall they fast. Now, Jesus, what he answers, he is very revealing about the nature of fasting. But I do want you to notice this is his pattern, by the way, in most of the Gospels. Jesus actually, this might sound wrong, so give me at least a chance to explain it. Jesus answers a lot of the questions given by Pharisees with irrational answers. What, Jesus? No, Jesus doesn't give irrational answers. Yes, he gives irrational answers. But the reason he gives them is perfectly rational, because the way the people were acting was irrational. If you look through his parables, you'll find that half of the stories he's telling are you're thinking, what? I'll give you one example without taking too much time. He talks about the vineyarders that are working in the vineyard, and here comes the owner of the vineyard sends a guy, and they kill him, and he sends another guy, and he kills him, and they send another guy, and he kills him. He says, I send my son. And they say, oh, if we kill him, we'll get the inheritance. Now, that's very irrational, right? Oh, if we kill his son, he'll give us the vineyard. That doesn't make sense. But that's exactly what they were doing in that time with Jesus Christ. So here we find a sort of irrational, ironic story. We're in a wedding feast scenario for all the people, and they come up to the wedding director, they come up to the bridegroom himself and say, we're all mourning right now. We're fasting today, so we can't eat any of the food you bought. Sorry, we're just grieved right now terribly. Anybody who came to that situation would say there's something drastically wrong with this wedding. By the way, if you have a wedding like that, you better double think what family you're marrying into. I mean, there's a situation right here that doesn't make sense. But Jesus points out in this story a powerful principle about fasting. In fact, several. And that is what we're going to look at. First, fasting is tied in one way or another to mourning born out of concern. Born out of mourning, born out of concern. There is no passage where fasting is associated with, note, joy. Not one. No one in the Bible is saying, I'm fasting today because I'm happy. I'm fasting because I'm free. I'm fasting because I know his eyes on the sparrow and I know he's watching me. No one says that. They weren't fasting because they were happy. They were usually fasting because something was concerning them. Whether it be personal sin, whether it would be the condition of their nation, whether it be something that was going on around them, their life was at risk, or someone they loved died, but it was never related to joy. And might I make the practical principle here that if you are in a joyful state of mind, do not adopt an artificial state of mourning. God wants us to be true to where we are. He doesn't want us to make up something. So I'll put that there. If, for example, the question we asked today, did you not fast once this year? If you did not have something that concerned you to the extent of fasting, I say there is no scriptural grounds to say you've sinned. Amen? So we approach this passage, and we have to say here, fasting is not commanded, but it is automatic and, note, natural. Now, if you fasted, and I think most of you probably have, you know that when you did, most of the cases, at least you could say, It was something I just was so overwhelmed with, I did it. Right? Fasting was something that overwhelmed you, and you naturally went into a state of, I need a fast for this. For example, even a lost person will fast when someone dies. And I don't want to say that's the same as the Christian fasting. We'll see from this passage that it isn't. But to some extent, they fast even without recognizing God, without considering prayer. It's something natural. And then we recognize when we come to fasting that in some senses it is similar to the lost person, but in other senses it is not. It is a person that's so concerned about something that he or she is not even note hungry. Something that's overwhelmed them to the extent they're not. I'll just say it out of my own experience. When I've fasted in the past, when I've fasted for a reason of something that concerned me, I didn't think, man, I want this day to get over so I can eat a big burger tomorrow morning. I didn't. There was no desire for food. Something had overwhelmed my attention and brought it to that. But when I have fasted for another reason, just to fast, I found the first thing I do is wish the day was over so I could eat the next morning. You know, I stay up till 12 so I can say I fasted the 24 hours, but still ate, you know. I don't think that's true fasting. If you start fasting and the first thing you do is say, I want this to be over, I want to eat, that's actually the opposite of true fasting. True fasting will be the opposite in the sense that one is distracting you from God, the food is distracting you from God, rather than God distracting you from the food. And that is what we're looking at in this passage as well, that true fasting comes from a concern, from mourning. The second thing, fasting is always tied in one way or another to, note, Jesus, to Jesus Christ himself. In a sense, this verse actually comes as a gentle rebuke to the disciples of John and the Pharisees. In a sense, he's saying, the reason my disciples cannot fast right now is because, note, I am here. By implication, he's saying, the reason you are fasting is because your fasting has nothing to do with me. The reason my disciples are fasting is because I am here. They are seeing a time that many of the prophets, many of the kings, many of the godly generation of the Old Testament, and many of us today in our generation wish we saw. We wish we could walk with Jesus the way they did, but they were there at that time. There was no time for them to mourn. When the God of heaven had descended in the form of man, King of kings and Lord of lords, and was walking with them, there simply was no time for fasting. The disciples didn't have that time. The King of glory was in their midst in a way that was not going to, note, continue much longer. And the next point's kind of tied to that. Fasting is a seasonal and not, note, forced upon anyone. Fasting is seasonal and not forced upon anyone. The verse says that there is going to be a time when the bridegroom is going to be taken from their midst. And oh, brothers and sisters, how we know what that means today, that he is not here in the same sense he was then. We look forward to the day he is physically in our presence. But right now, when something concerns us, we find ourselves at times praying and saying, God, Jesus, I need you. I don't know where you are. I just can't seem to find you. You seem so far away, and you feel like your prayer can't make it past the roof. That is what drives us to prayer. We can't just go to Jesus and say, what job is better, Jesus? We can't just go to Jesus and ask, is this the partner I need to be marrying? Now, we have prayer, we have the Holy Spirit, we have the direction of the Word of God. I don't want to belittle those things, but I do want you to realize we just can't do the same thing the apostles did then. And thus, we're driven to mourn and desire his return. The disciples had no time to mourn, but we do. He says that they will fast, notice again that when the bridegroom was taken away, it does say when then they will fast. It doesn't say they have to fast, but it also doesn't say they might fast. Again, I want to establish that balance. He says that they will fast, but he does not command them to do so, nor does he suppose that they will just throw the whole practice out entirely, which some people have tried to argue is the point of this passage, that they would fast one more time when Jesus was in the grave and never more. But there are a lot of problems to that, which I won't get into. Namely, one, that they fasted in the book of Acts much after his resurrection. But here we have a natural response for a Christian who is homesick for God. Homesick for God. We fast when we're homesick for God. And so we learn from this, as well as the rest of the Bible, that fasting is not getting a response from God. It's not about trying to merit Him. It's not trying to get control and say, now that I've fasted, God, you are obligated to do something for me. That's not fasting at all. Fasting is about giving a response to God from our heart, from a true, sincere desire. It is our old nature that tells us that God is wanting us to earn His favor. Earn His favor. That is not the grace era we live under. So let's look at the last point here and see how the old mentality is not compatible with the new life position of grace. The foundation of true fasting in all Christian living. Here it is, in a sort of obscure way, but very fascinatingly beautiful how Jesus puts it forth. No man putteth a piece of new cloth onto an old garment, for that which is put in to fill it up taketh from the garment, and the rent is made worse. Neither do men put new wine into old bottles, else the bottles break, and the wine runneth out, and the bottles perish, but they put the new wine into new bottles, and both are preserved. All right, when you look at this passage, you might overlook the significance, at least at first look. But I need your attention because, like I said before, I believe that the truths of this verse undergird the whole principle of Christian living. This may be one of the most important verses on the Bible with connection to the motivation of a new covenant believer. The Bible's overruling teaching is about fasting, and every good work is that it's not about earning favor with God. Even after you're saved, it is still a sense of gratitude towards God. And Jesus uses powerful illustrations for this. A new piece of cloth sewn onto an old coat. Now, we don't do this very often. Nowadays, we don't usually patch a pair of pants. Some pants are bought ripped. It's kind of an interesting situation, is it not? Very different. But the fact of the matter is, if you take an old piece of clothes that has a big rip in it, and you take a material and sew it over the top of that hole, and then throw them in the washer and dryer, the one that's already been pushed and shoved and has some endurance from that doesn't have any effect, but the new thing expands and often can rip and make a bigger hole. So you patched a hole only to end up with a bigger hole. You can try it. Not all materials do it to the same extent, but some do more than others. And the principle is pretty powerful here. It's the same as the very next principle. It says, the new wine is poured into old wineskin, right? Now, again, this is a little harder for us to understand because of the difference between the first century Israel and 21st century America. But the picture is exactly the same. You take an old wineskin that has had wine poured in it. It fermented, it expanded, it stretched, and then with time it hardened. And you drink all that and you do whatever you use that for, and you fill it up again with new wine. And the result is, as the other ferments, it can't expand any farther. The hardness of the wineskin is simply already hardened. It's already stuck. It's not going to move. And it is possible that it bursts. It bulges and eventually bursts out all the wine. It doesn't make sense to do that, Jesus says. It's not flexible. Now, what does this have to do with fasting? What does this have to do with anything? Jesus is amazing. He states something and you sit there for about 5 minutes wondering why he said that. And when you finally click, you're like, wow, I have never heard it put that way. And I don't think any man in the world would put things the way Jesus Christ did. But Jesus always brings the point right home, doesn't he? At first look, the profoundness of the verse is easily missed. But let's examine it carefully so we can see what it's talking about. The old there is not referring to the Old Testament necessarily, and some commentaries argue that it has some connection to that. I do believe that. But it's not necessarily Old Testament, but to the type of thinking characterized by the old nature. That's how I see this. Namely, that we have to earn our favor with God, that by fasting somehow we're getting something from God. We're making Him get on our side some way or another. Or that after I sin, now I've got to make up with it by punishing my body in some way. That's the old mentality. Before we're saved, we assume automatically that I've got to do something to get God's attention. That I've got to work for my salvation. I've got to work for this or that. And often that bleeds over into our Christianity and we live with the same type of principle. I've got to do this in order to not get struck down by the God sitting on the cloud with a lightning bolt. That is not a New Testament concept. That is not a New Testament belief. The new is referring to the grace and love that it was, note, purchased for us by Christ's death. He purchased the favor of God. If we are accepted in Jesus Christ, the Bible says we are complete in Him. He has given us everything necessary. He's given us all that we need. And we will stand before God regardless of our actions one day if you're truly saved. And we may lose rewards, but we could never lose our salvation, right? That's the new. The new is that nothing can separate us from the love of God. The new is that there is no more condemnation. The new is all of these clear principles laid out in the Scripture. As long as the King sits on His throne in glory, no tongue could ever tell us to depart from His presence because He has sealed this covenant. Now, if you're saved, you know this. You're thinking, you're just telling us things we've heard all of our life. And I know this is true, and if you are saved, and I'll assume that most of you are, we have heard this a lot. If you are not saved, I'll put the 1 second clause here and say, you need to stop doing works and you need to come to Christ and trust in His work. But if you're saved, you know this. So what does it have to do with us as saved? Well, let me just put it this way, that we as saved people, though we believe it theoretically, often don't believe it in practice, do we? When something goes wrong, we say, oh man, I must have done something to God. He's mad at me now. We shouldn't assume that. One person even said the chastising of God is in this covenant is amazing because it's by grace. The reason God corrects us is His love. And he said, that particular preacher said, we even learn eventually to kiss the hand that spanks us. Because it's by love that He does everything. So this should govern our thoughts. But we don't always think that way, do we? We easily fall into the thought that we are earning something with God. We easily believe that. And this is where the lost person and the saved person majorly differ. The new wine and the old wineskin. The saved person, let's say the wineskin, hears, for example, that principle so glorious laid out in the Scripture that where sin abounded, grace did overbound. And what is the result in the Christian's life? He says, this is a reason to serve God. He increases in holiness because he says, if Christ did this to me, if no matter how bad my sin was, His grace overwhelmed it, then I have a reason to do better because I love Him. On the other hand, when the old wineskin, the lost person, hears that same principle, where sin abounded, grace did overabound, they're going to react in several ways. One might react and say, this is why we know we can never be sure of our salvation, because if we ever did, we'd just sin all we want and say, where sin abounded, grace did overabound. We'd just sin all we want and make it an excuse for sin. And in a sense, that thought is right. Because there are people that take that stance, that say, oh, I can sin all I want because now grace has overwhelmed it. But see, this is the difference. The same new wine in the new wineskin that increases holiness can be an excuse for sin in the old wineskin. Isn't that amazing? Jesus says it will burst the old wineskin. Because unless there is a heart change in the person who is receiving this, the reaction could be drastically wrong. When our heart changes, all of a sudden our motivations change. And the reason we do things changes. And all of a sudden, the principle that guides us is God's grace, His amazing grace, His compassion, His love. The very fact that He died on the cross is our motive to live more righteously. Not because we're waiting to get condemned if we don't, but because He's already removed that. Our heart has changed, our desires have changed, and we no longer live under the fear of condemnation or the reckless living as an excuse. Everything we should do should be a reaction to grace, not law. The principle, this principle must govern everything we do. Why do you fast? Why do you go to church? Why do you pray? Why do you give tithes? Why do you read your Bible? Why do I go to the mission field? Why do you do something you do for the Lord? If you do these things in order to obtain favor and get out of the danger of being struck down by God, you're living under self-imposed bondage. In the Scripture, the highest motivator and the acceptable reason for complying to God's commandment is this: a heart that dearly loves Him, not someone who fears Him and is afraid of being again cast into condemnation. Now, perhaps some of you expected me to preach a sermon on how we should be passionately fasting more often than we are. Well, I'm not sure that should be connected to fasting, since the Scripture never does it. But one thing I do want to say is, if you walk away from this saying, "One more thing I have to do, I have failed you." But if you walk away saying, "One more thing God has allowed me to use to express to Him my concern, wow, then I've succeeded." Because that's what fasting was. Let me, just so you don't lose balance on any side, the Bible never says fasting is wrong. So if you ever read someone saying fasting is wrong, that's not scriptural. If you ever read someone saying you have to fast Thursday, Friday, and Tuesday, that's wrong too. Unless they have a good reason for it, and it's the same concern of your heart. And so be careful with that balance. As for, if you're wondering for a practical sermon on what you should do in order to have a good time fasting, I'm going to have to leave that sermon to Pastor Shaw sometime. He can break down the details of what the Scripture teaches about why they fasted, for concern, for seeking guidance, for those type of things, and he'll bring it out. For now, let's go to the Lord in prayer and seek His guidance for the next Sunday schools as well. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day. We do thank You that we live under a new era, that the new wine is put in a new wineskin, that You changed it, that though a leper can't change its spots, You have changed us. And though without You we could do nothing, now we are empowered to serve You, and the reason we serve You is changed. Lord, we serve You out of a loving heart. We serve You because we love You. We serve You because we know, as Your Scripture says, that we love You because You first loved us. Your love is our motivator. Your grace is our strength. Your mighty hand is what sustains us. Let us honor You for that. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Draw me close to You. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear You say that I'm Your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find the way, bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are close to you.
Draw me close to you.
Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. There's nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you. Thank you. come. We come to worship you alone. No other king on the throne. Spirit, come and set our hearts ablaze.
Precious Father, thank you for words that are put to song that we as a body get to lift the feeling of our heart to you corporately together. What other place could we go where as a body, as a group, we get to join with the angels and give thanks to our God all together, opening our hearts to you. And just as Rolando shared this morning, Father, that it wouldn't be something we're forced to do or have to do, but something that we realize we get to do in a heart of thanks and of gratitude, no matter where we are in our lives. If it's a position of joy and happiness or a position of joy and sorrow, that we recognize that with you at the center, with you at the reason for our life, Father, what a privilege it is to bring you thanks this morning. Worthy is the Lamb, you are holy.
the Lamb, you are holy.
Let's lift our voices, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Celebrate with our King this morning.
Here we go. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to Him a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. For me, Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace. is insufficient for me. My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. He will give his angels charge over me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me, for me, for me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me.
I will celebrate.
I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song.
Amen. Ah. Thank you very much. It's such a privilege to sing on a Sunday morning. I love getting up here and just joining with you. It's such a privilege. Nothing's perfect, praise God, but he is. And so we recognize again and again, thank goodness I am not God, but he is. And so to allow him to rule in our lives and to step out and follow him in faith, knowing that we will fail, that we will sin, but his grace is greater and just sufficient, incredibly sufficient. And what a gift to give to our friends and to our neighbors that we serve a loving, forgiving, risen God. So I just want to encourage you as you stick around for Sunday school, spend time with one another, fellowship, and as you go outside of this holy huddle that we're in this morning, go out and just bring glory to God throughout your week. You're dismissed. Thank you.